This way, yeah? We tried to do something a little experimental. And I tried to show the students, or rather let the students discover and explore beyond the normal design process. It's a concept I call zoology. So it's the study of relationships. The idea really was to try to create an awareness in the students beyond the normal design process. When we have a project, we're always limited by time and budget. And in this case, it was to explore the kind of knock-on effect, if you like to call it very simply consequences. What happens if? And so if you produce a product, what happens if? And it was great fun working with the students, and I have to say it was a project exercise or a workshop which we really designed, everybody designed, and I very much enjoyed that, and you made a great contribution in the way that it worked, because I wasn't really too sure how this was going to work since it was an experimental kind of approach. And it was a great honor also to work with BJ here, or as he's also known, Professor Babbitt. And that was great fun because it helped me to get more of an insight into the working way, which is different in Germany to the way in which you work here, at least I think so. And I very much enjoyed that because the students make a great contribution in how we worked on the workshop, and they designed it as we went along. And I think that was also important. It wasn't a normal kind of a design exercise in the sense that there should be a product at the end of it. What was important was, as I say, that they should actually explore the extent to which things are networked and related and there are consequences in our design actions. So that was the exercise. And they evolved. They had a number of choices of objects which they suggested, which they would like to explore. And I think I've shown you the kind of told you the kind of idea that we had, but I think it would be rather fun if now they told their experience and made their presentation. But I thank you very much indeed. It was great fun, and it was really very enjoyable. You are.
Right. So we figured that we would be like the sixth or seventh group to come in. So good morning, rise and shine. Also, actually, the main reason we put this up was I think we've just woken up to the idea of sustainability. So rise and shine. And that's why I think all of us are here, because we've woken up to that. So everybody's thinking about it. So we're not going to go into any pessimistic scenarios or anything like that. So the idea here, the entire presentation is based on the idea of what's mine is yours. So what we want to do, hopefully, is by the end of the presentation, just like us, you walk away with something that you can add to your design process. So Apoor will talk about this a little more.
Usually, the creative process, almost everyone here knows what it is and how we go about, but what we do is we just start with the brief and research, okay? Once we get the brief, whether it's a classroom assignment or it comes from a professional, we read the brief and we start research. Even before we think about what we can do throughout the project, we read the brief and research starts. Then goes the synthesis, and we try to bring out ideas wherever we can find, every nook and cranny we look, and whatever we can get our hands on, we bring it together and try to make sense out of it. Then once we have done, we think we have found something meaningful, we try to get something into prototyping and see if others feel the same way about it. We try to test it. And then ultimately, if everyone agrees, okay, it works, you try to deploy. But we decided, okay, why don't, if you're trying to get into the whole sustainability thing, why not take a closer look at the process that we are following? Like, from synthesis to prototyping, like, this is one of the major stages where we put a lot of things, most of the things that we learn in design school, we put it like ergonomic study, forms, colors, and finish. When you're thinking about your product or any entity that you're going to design, why not include sustainability right here? You know, make sustainability part of the process. Like, you're not going to make a project and then say, okay, now let's try to make it sustainable. It's not going to work. You can't think of taking the most dirtiest of the most polluting thing, and then okay, now let's make this eco-friendly, right? It has to be part of the process. But the question comes how, and that is one of the main things we were concentrating on this workshop.
Okay, hello everyone. What we was, you know, as a group, we looked at an exercise where we picked a product and we saw how it actually was in the beginning and how it ended. And next slide. So we chose our product as a shoe because it wasn't complex to such a large extent like a computer or a camera or something. And what we did was we segregated all the components of a shoe, like you know, we totally whatever, segregated it, like, you know, we had leather, we had foam, we have metalized, we have fabric and stuff like that. So each of us, we were split into groups of two or three, and all of us picked one topic, and we did our research on each of them, and we studied it, we analyzed it, we scrutinized it, right from its birth to its death. And I'll give you one example. We picked fabric, just to give you an insight into it. What we did is, in fabric, what do we use fabric for in a shoe? We usually use it as polyester or as canvas. Both of them are cotton-based. So we started looking at it right from all the processes, like from harvesting to ginning, then you know, from spinning, dyeing, and then it goes through weaving, and then after that it's machine cut, and then you get the cloth, and then it is stitched up to the shoe, and then after that comes the next process where the human being actually wears it, yeah, and it's time to dispose it because it's worn out and maybe there are holes in it, who knows. So we checked on the possibilities of as to where it might go after it's, you know, used. So one possibility might be the garbage bin, the other might be recycled, the other might be reused, and the other might be stored for eternity, maybe in your attic or something. If it's gone to your garbage bin, what happens there? Either it's recycled, or it goes to a landfill, or it is incinerated. Once it's incinerated, maybe we can use the ash for you know, bricks and for carbon extraction and stuff. Then if it's recycled, then it can be used to make heavy paper and for paper mache and stuff like that. Now we didn't just stop at finding out the processes. We also, you know, went ahead in finding out, you know, as to what a certain process involves, you know, right from the inputs to the outputs. So I'll give you one example, that's dyeing. And what we did was, in each topic we went in depth. Right now I'll just talk about dyeing. What is the next one? Yeah, so how do you dye fabric? It's either synthetically dyed or it's naturally dyed. Yeah, and how is it synthetically dyed? You either use cadmium, or you use sulfur, you use phosphorus, you use all kinds of chemical pigments. If it's naturally dyed, it's either organic pigments and also plus water and stuff. Now, if it is synthetically dyed, there are repercussions. You know, it can be because of the chemical residual that's left, it can cause water pollution, and because of that, there are a lot of health hazards that, because of which, it's not good for health. Yeah, and otherwise, if you use natural dyes, then it actually helps the system because it's biodegradable residue and it actually goes back to the cycle. So voila, you know, you actually you found a design intervention. So I guess that's about it.
Basically, what we've done here is we've shown that through this system of thought, what happens is we study this system.
We have a very basic idea of what processes are used to create a certain product and certain components of that product. But what we don't do, and which we did in this particular workshop, is at each step, what are the inputs and what are the outputs? And if we look into that, what happens is you're able to identify certain areas for design intervention. Like this. So say you identify dyeing and recycling as areas for design intervention. When you look into it in detail, you are met with certain choices that you could make when you're suggesting the methods of manufacturing, and when you have these choices so clearly spelled out for you, you can make the right choice. And if you've done your research right, you can also convince your client, because I'm guessing the natural dyes usually end up costing a lot more. And if you're able to do this, say dyeing, this is one example. Recycling, if you went into it, you would probably realize that you should design for it to disassemble. Hence, you go back two steps, design for disassembly, and then move ahead again. And voila, you have a sustainable product.